Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another video. Today's going to be a little bit more of a chilled out video. Give me some slack, all right? Because I have a lot to share with you guys. Today, what I want to go through with you guys is just a little bit of what the media kind of, you know, their incentive, okay? Because I see the same thing because I'm kind of growing into a little media company myself, right? Casey Burns Investing. And as I look at my revenue trends, I see the same thing with my revenue trends as the media's. So today I want to talk to you guys about which types of views videos actually get views, right? It tends to be these ones that are news related, right? Tends to be these ones that people are searching for. It tends to be these ones that are controversial, a lot of negative energy, okay? And whether you want to say that negative energy from one group is worse than the negative energy from another group, I'm just trying to refrain for a little bit, but I do want to take you guys through some of my analytics here. This is the BLM one, which typically in my BLM videos, I tell people to become self-reliant and focus on yourself rather than trying to derive your power from someone else. As we saw, that one made 666. A little eerie there, but anyways, this one, market review. Let's see how much this one made. Anyone who saw this one probably knew what was going to happen in the market this week, right? We talked about how tech was making an uptrend, making an uptick. We talked about the week before, we talked about how, you know, tech can't keep on selling down in one direction indefinitely, right? We saw how oil was getting cheap, and then we see oil kind of making a tick up. So there's a lot of good information in those. Whereas, you know, a video about Bad Baby, not helpful at all, really. Makes me $5, right, versus 38 cents. So there's that demand signal to be outrageous, right, to make the people mad. Give them what they want. People want to be mad. But today, I just wanted to talk to you guys about the title of the video, which is How Broke Are Millennials? So I actually got an email in my inbox, and it was talking about this, why millennials don't own homes. So in going through this this article, I want to show you guys the article, but I also want to show you some background, and also this lady over here, this millennial who's refusing to pay their loans. Shout out to Todd Baldwin. I did watch that whole video. It kind of inspired this video as well, but basically, let me just sum it up. She's refusing to pay $80,000 in loans, which she co-signed with her dad. Okay, so not only is she bringing down her own credit, which she is kind of mystified of, you know, why I can't get a $3,000 loan to go get a car. You can't get a $3,000 loan to go get a car because you don't pay back your loan. So why would somebody give you a loan? You know, I'm not going to sit here and give her a loan of my money because I've actually had the experience of losing that money to people. But basically what she's able to do is if you make under a certain amount of money, I think it's 20 or 25 years, I'll throw it on the screen right here, you can basically charge off your loans and you never pay it and the taxpayer ends up paying it for you. And for me, the worst part about this video was that, number one, she's willing to live in poverty for 20 years, which, you know, if you would just work and save and just get out of that hole, like I was in the same situation. I was in $90,000 in debt, so I had more debt than this person. I just worked, you know, I didn't take a weekend. You can ask any of my close friends. They didn't see me for like two and a half years. All right. And that's not something that is, you know, I'm not glamorizing it, but it is what it is. Like if you really want to make it, you have to be willing to sacrifice something. You have to be willing to put in work for years and years. Right. And now I'm about to cross the 150 in net worth mark later this week, and I'm going to max my Roth IRA. So it's just, now I'm on with my life. You know, I'm a homeowner. Credit score is a lot better. Everything's moving in the right direction because I just put in 3 years of work. So to someone like myself, seeing somebody like her story, you know, it just comes across as like this person's allergic to work. This person couldn't do a simple Google search, which I'm about to do for you guys and show you the importance of credit and how to get your credit up. So I wanted to show you guys my Lending Club account because I promised this a long time ago, but there's really some insights in here. Okay, so when I went in and started Lending Club, it was basically, let's just call it January 2019, because I think I started it maybe December 2018, but just for math's sake, let's say that it was about 2 years and 5 months ago. Let's just say it was about 2 years and 5 months ago. So essentially, I thought in my head, I was like, the credit score is stupid. You know, I thought the credit score was racist, but like, quite frankly. So I was like, I'm just going to lend money to anyone. So let's check out what happened with that. I just lent money to anyone with terrible credit score. So we see down here, default 0, charged off 7. Okay, so I had 36 notes, and of those 36 notes, 7 people didn't pay me back. Okay, so of the 36, only 29 people either. See, we got 13 fully paid, we got 16 that are still paying back the loan. Okay, so this is why, and look over here, adjusted net annualized return, 0.01%. Okay, so people think these banks are making so much money on all these loans. My interest rates collectively are about 18%. So more details. We see in here that I've got type E. These are basically based on people's credit scores. So I had a bunch of bad loans, essentially. And a lot of those people are the ones who actually went on to default on their loans. I didn't give money to a lot of people that basically had good credit, and I ended up, they didn't pay me back. So how does that tie into all of these other things that we're talking about today? Why don't millennials have homes? People refusing to pay back their student loans, you know, me working off to pay my student loans. Let's get into this article. But anyways, it's just all tied together. It's all the same mindset. It's all the same, like, you know, people don't understand these things. That's why I went through the media thing and the lending club thing until you're actually on the producer side, until you're actually giving the loan, until you're actually making the TV program, right? Then you understand that the behavior of the consumer. So anyways, I hope that's some good insights. But let's move into this. Why are millennials so far behind? Okay, so some interesting things in here. Lack of savings. 63% of millennial respondents in the survey, this is Bigger Pockets, by the way, said that they have $0 in savings towards a down payment. There's a middling 22% that they said they had $1 to $9,999. Only 15% said they had $10,000 or more saved. Now, think about this. Who doesn't have six months of expenses that cost over $10,000, right? So only 15% of millennials are essentially doing their money right. So everybody has to pay at least $10,000 for 6 months of expenses for the most part. I mean, I don't necessarily on this deployment, but unless you're extremely frugal and you live in a very low cost of living area, typically it's going to cost you more than $2,000 a month to live. So like, basically that tells me that 85% of millennials are struggling financially, So the average American down payment of 6%, more than 85% of millennials would not be able to purchase a house. All right, moving on. Pew Research says 39% of millennials have a bachelor's degree, 10% more than their parents. This stuff down here, yada, yada, yada. Millennials are waiting to get married, 28, 30 in males. Flocking to cities, millennials want to live in the cities. 88% of millennials live near an urban center. That's not what we're here to talk about. We are here to talk about, this is what I wanted to talk about. 38% of home purchases in 2020 were made by millennials, but they're still far behind the previous generations. By the age of 30, 48% of Gen X had homes, and by the age of 30, 51% of baby boomers had homes. And you can argue whatever you want to about that. I mean, my argument there would be that we are pumping the price of homes up by inserting all this cheap money, and we're making it very hard to afford these homes. So for example, down here, San Francisco median sold price of a single family home was $1.3 million as of February 2021. And we just continue to pump more money into the housing market and tell people that they don't have to pay their bills. So the housing crash cannot come. All right, and this just shows a little bit of the importance of actually having good credit. So look at how much money you could essentially save by having good credit. So even though Dave Ramsey says, don't worry about a credit score if you're worried about a credit score, and you're just, you know, that's what broke people do or whatever he says. Look at all this money you can save by having a good credit score. And you don't have to have debt per se to have a good credit score. I'll show you guys this in my own Credit Karma. I'll pull it up and I'll show you guys that besides my house, I don't have any debt, but I have good credit and I'm not paying any interest to anyone. To my mortgage, but that's actually being paid for me by a renter, but that's a different story. besides my house, I don't have any debt, but I have good credit, okay? And that helps you with all these other things, okay? Credit card rates, insurance rates, which, you know, insurance is something that you can't get away from. You have to have car insurance. You have to have those other things. You don't necessarily, credit card rates don't matter if you don't have credit card debt. Auto loan rates don't matter as much if you don't have auto loan debt. Mortgage rates surely matter if you want to go in and leverage real estate or just not pay so much on your own primary residence. All right, and the last thing I want to pop up here is, I mean, I pretty much just popped this up just to flex. I'm just kidding. But I mean, you know, flex a little bit. 781, that's what my credit is. And I'll show you guys later, but I don't have any debt besides my mortgage. So I'm gonna pop this screen recording up really quick and I'll show you guys the factors. Okay, so payment history, that one is going to be 35%. So the way to get an excellent is to have 100% or 99%. A good way, so as you see here on my screen recording, it says 187 payments. So that's because I have a lot of accounts open. So if you only have, let's say you had one account open. So every 1 year you'd have 12 payments. So if you miss one payment, you are already automatically go down to you know, a pretty low percentage. You're gonna go to 11 out of 12, whatever that is as a percentage. I'm not a computer and I'm not gonna take out the calculator right now. The next credit factor is credit card utilization. So you wanna keep that between 0 and 9 to be excellent. And then the next tier is 10 to 29. So credit card utilization, that one is 30%. So essentially, if you wanna have an excellent credit score, I would keep that between 0 and 9%. So what does that mean? That means if you have a $10,000 credit limit, you need to keep that under $900, okay? So good way to make that better is to just have more available credit. So you have to take out more credit cards. You don't necessarily need to max them out. You do not need to carry a balance. All right, next let's move on to derogatory marks. Okay, derogatory marks, you wanna have 0, okay? Essentially what a derogatory marks are is that you didn't pay your bill. Age of credit, you see mine is pretty bad because I apply for credit pretty often. But what you want for excellent is 9+ years. The next tier down is 7 to 8 years. So all these things, if you can get to excellent, these are gonna give you an 850 or close to it. It doesn't matter. Pretty much after 760, it doesn't really matter. Like the fact that I have a 781, it doesn't really matter. Total accounts, you want this to be 21+ to be excellent, and you want this to be 11 to 21, that's the next tier. So I've got 23 accounts, so I'm in the excellent tier there. Hard inquiries, that is the last one, and it is 0, and 1 to 2 is still pretty good. Okay, so obviously if you have 0, that's not really using your credit, so I don't personally recommend just keeping 0 around. Right now I have 4. I'm waiting for 1 to fall off so that I can apply for another credit card and get some bonuses, get some travel points. But anyways, hopefully that helps somebody out there. I had to react to all these things. I'm seeing the media manipulation. I'm seeing kind of the I don't know where to go type of mentalities. You know, if somebody was told what I'm telling you guys right now, how to increase your credit, how to, you know, just put in those extra hours working, how to, you know, how to really just get out of the same situation that this individual is in, they wouldn't be making the decision to be in poverty for 20 years, okay? You only need to be essentially in artificial poverty for 3 years. That's what I basically did. I put myself into artificial poverty in the sense of not spending, right? Pretending that I didn't have any money and putting it all towards the debt, and now I'm putting it all towards my investment. So I'm still in a forced artificial poverty, but if it really hit the fan, I would have plenty to fall back on. So that's a comfortable position to be in. So anyways, hopefully you guys like the video. Make some good decisions out there. Keeping your nose to the grindstone if that's what time of life you're in. That's what season you're in. And should I give them the old outro or should I give you guys the new outro? I don't know. I'll see you guys in the next video. It's something about the girl.